said the car's going past.
Yeah, do you want the door closed? I can stand outside the door so I can see the people coming in.
Yeah, but you want to listen too, don't you? So.
Yeah,
we'll wait till
yes.
The two definite arrivals come.
Okay.
Yeah. They're going to be quite sure on there a bit later anyway, I think.
Sure.
Probably still people going on from work, I should say.
Shouldn't be a problem. I'm not having to talk to the back of the room, so.
If you want to live like me, take your time.
Not really. Up to India, that was 2007.
Yes.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Apart from summer holidays.
Yeah.
Day by day, stone by stone. Build your secret zone.
Amazing.
Day
we were out
just
going
somewhere
like
that. I went while Simon was working. So he was involved.
Well, yes.
So we took, first week we went to Rajasthan, which was sort of north.
Yes.
And the second week we went south.
Yeah.
We went to Gunning Public. Africa was when I was 19.
You have a relative like Kenya or something.
Yeah, he's still there.
That's cousins.
That's right.
Yeah.
He's still going strong.
Really? Been there some years then.
Yeah, he had a child at the age of 72.
Really?
Yeah. His wife wasn't.
No, I thought that would have been
a bit of a miracle if she was.
Yeah, it would have been, wouldn't it?
Yeah. Oh, yeah, my young bro's always late, I forgot.
Yeah.
We'll probably get here 1 second before so. Yeah, they've just had their second anniversary.
Yes.
7 weeks, 2 years.
Yeah. So it's gone quick, actually. Well, they've been travelling for a year and a quarter, I think, they were travelling.
I know.
Well, that's why he said he was in between jobs. I've listened to the Asikos. They've sorted out with the job, has he?
He has now, yeah.
He's
landed one, yeah.
Yeah.
No, they bought somewhere.
Have they?
Yeah. And they were renting that out while they were travelling.
Yes.
Yes.
Not really losing it too much.
No,
that's true.
He's
a civil engineer as well. No, he's a surveyor.
Surveyor?
Yeah. I think, I'm not sure if he's chartered or not. That's what he's doing.
Your grandpa was an engineer, wasn't he?
Well, he was a surveyor
as well, yes.
And Paul's a civil engineer.
Yes.
My granddad.
Paul
is a civil engineer.
Day by day, stone by stone.
So it's not far from Juliet. Oh, yeah, because
she's on the board. Yeah. Well, she works for Fulham, doesn't she? She's a social worker. Well, she's been swapped and changed various sections.
Well, she's got that. Quite a few years in children's services, which was very stressful. And about 4 or 5 years ago, she moved into mental health. And then she trained to be a forensic social worker. So she's actually dealing with the criminally insane. But some of the way down from the secure possibly to
it's eventually
but then a social worker will have to keep an eye on with it in the community to make sure. So she does have quite a bit to do. She's actually based in a hospital, isn't she?
Yes, that's where her office is.
It starts to get quite challenging sometimes.
Yeah, quite a challenge for her. She's enjoying it, isn't she? So she enjoys it, yeah. Less stressful than working with young adults.
Yeah.
You know, because all the problems
are
getting them accommodation, education.
Sometimes she would have to do a whole week's on call for assessments. Well, assessments could go on for hours and hours. She has to call in the police, psychiatrists, you know, they have to decide whether the tumour can actually section people.
You better not meet.
But it's a kind of a long process, and some time, you know.
I'm just going to bring this closer because I don't want to sort of have to shout over your heads.
Okay.
Is it 7 o'clock yet?
Just coming to.
Hi, sorry.
Do you know what you're coming to?
Yeah, roughly.
Oh, you do?
We do roughly, yeah. Oh, yeah.
It's not an IT seminar.
We did read up.
Hello, ma'am.
Hello, darling. Do you want to sit in front or the back?
Well, sit in the front, because I think you might be the only ones here, so.
Yeah, just make yourself comfortable.
Thank you.
Thank you.
It's a nice little room.
My two greatest skeptics. This should be good. Okay. Right, well, I'm going to start now.
Yeah, do you want me to close the door?
Maybe, if that's okay.
Yeah, because I can stand, I can stand here, I can see if people
there's a sign there,
isn't yes, that's
so,
right.
Yeah. Okay,
yeah?
Thanks. Okay, well, thank you for making the effort to come to this talk, Surviving the 21st Century. And I will just say, when I first envisioned doing this talk was probably back in June-ish sort of time. And since then, typically, and I kind of knew this would happen, I've had quite a sort of a new influx of information, knowledge, which adds to what I'm talking about, also supports a lot of what I've come up with on my own, but is knowledge from another person. But that will be in part two. So part one, I'll start now. Okay, so I could probably just do this talk and say, love is the answer, and thank you, good night. But, we all kind of know that. But, do we sort of always think about the full extent of love and how far and how powerful it is? So I don't think we usually do. We usually think about the love of a partner, friends and family. But also the love of the universe, the fact of existence. We could go around in our day-to-day lives feeling that the love of existence, and that would probably do us a lot of good. So you could sort of think during the day, you could also send some of your love to people you know. You could spend half an hour a day just thinking about some people you know, sending them your love, and also it's always a two-way process, so feeling that too. I'm going to need my drink a lot today. I can see this.
You better tell them it's water.
It is. This is rainwater.
Yes.
Not wine.
We thought it might be rainwater.
So what? Because you probably saw
in the article.
Yes.
It said rainwater. You're right. Yes. Yeah.
So, but I'll get on to that bit anyway. So, yeah, love is the answer. I mean that, you know, it's written in all the songs. But what we think of when we think of love. You know, when you think of sort of sending love to someone, you project it. But you know, it's got to be a feeling. It's not words in your head of "I love you, I love you, I love you." It has to be, you know, from, if you like, the soul, and you feel that love and you send it. So I think that would be a good thing to practice. Is there any, by the way, if you've got any questions, I mean, there's only four of us, you can probably just ask anything, or if you'd like to add anything to it, you're welcome to, of course, as well. Okay? Mm-hmm. Are we all happy on this point so far?
Yes.
And can you see this okay?
Yes,
yeah.
Yes, thank you, yes.
Okay. So, the miracle of existence, if you actually think about it long enough, the fact that we exist isn't at all logical. There's no real logic that we should even be here. And if when I've been doing my philosophy over the years and I've been sitting there thinking, quite often I've almost thought myself out of existence. Well, that's what it's felt like. But when you get to that point, you kind of really do appreciate the fact that we are here. That is a fact. We can't deny we are here. And being grateful for it is a good thing. But I want to talk about, so what do we really know? What do we know for absolute sure? Well, that's one thing. We know we exist. So it's a good starting point. And we also know we were born. We can't probably remember much before it. Most of us can't even remember far back into our childhood either. But we all know it happened. And that's another thing we know for absolute sure. So then there's all these other things that come into our head that we hear. And obviously the first thing that we hear from is our parents and what our parents tell us. Then we go to school and we have all what our teachers tell us. What our friends tell us, we read books. We hear entertainers and TV and in films. There won't always be words and instructions, but you're given someone else's perception of life, and you take that on and ponder on it and you think about it. But most of this we can't really take as absolute truth. We can't take that as fact, because it's just what somebody else has said. But experience, what we experience in our life, That's something else we can know for sure. So, I'm trying to think of an example of that. You have experiences with your friends as you're growing up, and you feel that somebody likes you or they dislike you, and you know, you're not always sure on the first time of meeting someone if that's the case. But, you know, it starts to build up as you meet different people, you get an idea. So you can start to sort of base a real truth on what you experience. Okay? Okay. So now I want to sort of just talk about the power of a single thought. a thought can change your life. One day you might just be walking along and a thought pops into your head and it's like a knocking a domino over. Eventually it may take time, but a thought can just pop into your head and it can change your life. And how often do we set such a high price on what we're doing in our thoughts? Most of the time we're thinking what we need to get from the shops, that day-to-day stuff, but if we start really thinking about life or whatever your desires are, you know, you can really, it's powerful. It's powerful what thought can start. So we got the analogy of the seed planted in the fertile ground, and after a length of time, you can grow a strong tree, and that can be a very hard thing to get rid of. Because obviously, what can happen here is you can have a wrong thought. You know, you can think something which isn't correct, but you can hold on to that, and it builds and builds as time goes on, and before you know it, you've got this really strong tree of belief, if you like, and it would be quite hard to get rid of if it was wrong. So it's the importance of knowing what's right and wrong is actually extremely important for your whole life. You all with me so far?
Yeah.
Yes.
I have a question, Steve.
Yeah?
Where do our thoughts come from?
Well, I would say our thoughts are in our mind, rather than... Thoughts can come from a lot of things. There would be, what's the word when it's underneath the surface, sort of like an advertising board may present you something, but actually it's triggering other thoughts. Subconsciously, sort of, you know, making you think something. Some thoughts, you know, could come from other people, potentially.
Mm.
That's something we might touch on in part two, okay? But for the moment, we're just talking about our normal thoughts in our mind. Words in your mind, for the moment. So I just want to talk again about the belief and truth and knowing. So again, this is about thoughts, but eventually they create your belief systems. Whether we want them or not, we have them. You have these reference points here would be your what you would consider as facts in your own mind. And if you string a few facts together, what I've called belief strings, then you have a belief. They form the basis for all our decisions. So they are, again, very important, because every time you make a decision, you base it on your belief systems. So it affects absolutely everything you do. We can take an example with rainwater and tap water. I've now, for the last 2 years, gone fully over to rainwater, and in my belief system, this is much nicer for me than tap water.
Mm-hmm.
But the vast majority of people would want tap water or bottled water, would think that rainwater was perhaps full of bugs and maybe...
I was going to say that. Yeah,
but
you know, if it is safe for you to drink.
Is it filtered at all? You do
I don't filter it now, no. I did start off filtering it.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, the first time I probably only boiled it. I did do that for a little while, I boiled
yes.
it.
Yes.
So I kind of gradually I probably may have accustomed to it slightly. I do remember when I first drinking it, I did feel a bit of sharpness on my throat.
Yes.
But that seems to have gone.
Yes.
And now for me to drink tap water is I don't make a big thing about it, but if I ran out of rainwater, mm-hmm. I'd be quite upset, mm-hmm. and I'd miss my rainwater. Mm-hmm. Whereas most people, if they were to drink rainwater, they'd probably be a bit worried about drinking.
Have you harvested yours
now? Yeah, a flat or a... Yeah, I now have two water butts, yeah. just coming off my roof, yeah. but how I thought about it was, well, the rain's falling on it continually, so it's had a good wash over the last several years. And I probably didn't use the first water from the water butt. So that I probably used the first load to water the plants. Yes. So the water butts had a rinse as well.
Well, what about the pollution that gets onto the roofs? That's washed out in the water. It's not.
Yeah, so in a way, there are all these elements that you could worry about.
Yes, yes.
So if I was to recommend to you to drink rainwater, well, I probably shouldn't do that. You would have to take your own life in your own hands right. and think about it.
Yes.
But if I showed you a list of all the... Sorry, but I'm just... You can't sit there because you're in the way.
Oh, I see.
If I showed you a list of all the chemicals
yes.
in rainwater, which I did look up,
yes.
So Thames Valley, they publish a list of all the chemicals, known chemicals, in the tap water,
yes.
and I looked at one from 2010, and the list was two A4 pages,
right.
and the whole second A4 page was all pesticides mm. and things from farming. Extremely low amounts,
yes.
but that to me, I thought, there's a lot of stuff in there. And so, weighing up what's better, rainwater, which is essentially, you could say, from God, or the tap water from Thames Valley Water, who are recycling that water, and you flush the toilet, and it goes down, and then they send it back up. You know, to me, that's also... So I was weighing them up. And
is that filtered well?
It's filtered well, and also, you know, when they're making sure it's clean, one of the things they do is they make sure the level of chlorine is high enough
yeah.
that it's killing any sort of bacteria.
Yeah.
But chlorine isn't good for our insides. It kills good bacteria and bad bacteria. And I don't know if you know, but we are dependent on bacteria in our systems.
Mm.
Mm. So it's a case of weighing it up, and then you
yes.
having the knowledge, you weigh it up for yourself and you make the decision, and maybe you choose to experiment again.
Yeah. And that's fresh rainwater we're talking about, isn't it? Fresh water, rainwater.
Yeah.
Right, because we've got quite a number of water butts all the way around our roofs.
Yeah.
And if the water stood there for more than a few weeks,
yeah,
does go
start to go green,
nasty, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it could become stagnant, and I suppose you'd start off with an empty one
yes.
and cleaned out.
Yeah.
And if you're using it all the time, well, then there's movement in the water,
yes.
and that would stop it from going stagnant.
Yeah.
Yes.
Also, it's probably better in the shade, not
yes.
in a sunny place, and obviously, you need a
yes.
lid.
Yeah.
So, this is what now I've 2 years. Drinking rainwater.
Yes.
I think I rinsed out the water butt once,
mm.
so it's still okay with me. Sometimes, sometimes I just do the tap quick and then turn it off, because sometimes a little slug
yes.
has just gone up the spout,
yes.
and it's the first thing that comes up. But if you've seen my thing. I've also tried
no
eating
problem,
it's organic.
Yeah, so we'll get on to that in a bit about the nature.
Yeah.
I have a question,
yeah.
Stephen. So do you have a tank that collects all this rainwater and then you use it like a water tank and you drink from there? or?
Yeah, so no, I fill up bottles in there. I've got the 5 litre bottles that you buy.
Mm-hmm.
I bought those, I emptied out the water straight away. And filling it up with the rainwater, and I put it in the house so that it's ready to use.
Right.
And I use about 5 litres a day. And also when I have a bath, I put 15 litres of rainwater in, and obviously with the hot water,
mm-hmm.
I need to use the tap. Because we also absorb water through our skin, especially if we're dehydrated. You can absorb quite a lot of water through your skin. And I only have one bath a week, so it doesn't become too much.
Mm-hmm.
But if I'm starting to run out of rainwater, then I stop using it in the bath, and I would sort of prioritise my drinking water.
Mm-hmm.
And what would I say? I actually noticed straight away quite a big difference with my bodily odours. I mean, like I said, I only have one bath a week, and I don't usually do any other washing. And yes, at the moment. I generally have a bit of a whiff,
yes.
which I don't particularly mind, and I've been running a business, and people haven't stopped using me, so it can't be that bad. And also, I do notice if I go and spend some time at somebody else's house, where I'm drinking a lot more of the tap water, then the whiff becomes a bit stronger. But before I was drinking rainwater, I was having 2 baths a week. And I was feeling like I quite needed them. And as soon as I started drinking the rainwater, I just didn't feel like I needed a bath.
Mm-hmm.
So I waited a week. And there's also been times where I thought I could probably wait another week. And, you know, a bath is an enjoyable thing, but it's a bit of a luxury. So, you know, if it's not every... And I really wouldn't want to do it every day. Because it's such a pain, so. Yeah, I did notice quite an immediate difference. So I'm thinking what's happening is when I'm drinking the tap water, I'm taking on these chemicals and the body's having to force them out, and that's causing the problem. Because that's the process, the sweating and things like that is the body sort of excreting the toxins out of the body. And I don't use any deodorant either, because I notice most of them have aluminium in them. And the other reason is, so in a sense, you know, this aluminium, you're spraying it on, and then what does the body have to do? It has to force it out again.
Mm-hmm.
So you kind of make the cells smell nice for a bit, but you're actually increasing the toxins that your body has to force out. And I quite like my BO as well. Sorry to say.
the idea of showering every day is, you know, it's quite a modern thing, really, isn't it? We never, you know, I don't know how far you have to go back to when it was quite common to have a bath every week. You know, that far.
Yeah.
That long ago.
We used to have a bath night, didn't we?
Yeah. We used to have a bath night, you know.
Yeah.
And
but you know, if you live in India in the Mumbai, you need a shower every day, don't you?
Yeah.
Because you come back from being out there for a few hours. You'd scrape your hair and it's black.
But I guess that's, you know, pollution and everything else. And
yeah.
But if you lived out...
So living in a city makes it... You probably need to wash a bit more. But I think we're quite countryfied out here. It's not too bad.
So I just asked, mineral water?
Yeah.
I'm assuming that, you know, when you get mineral water, whether it's Evian or whatever, from the Scottish Highlands, and I'm assuming that's kind of treated. But do the chemicals and everything else that go into
that? Well, they do list what's in there. So there won't be chlorine in most of these mineral waters. But like I said, when I bought the 5 litre bottle, I emptied it out because I bought the cheap one, Cumbria Water, I think it was. And I looked at the list and there's quite a high amount of fluoride in there. And also that's another reason for avoiding tap water is toxic fluoride is probably to be avoided as well, because it's known that fluoride will attach very easily to any any other substance, and if it attaches to aluminium, it can actually pass the blood-brain barrier, and It goes in there and apparently calcifies the pineal gland, which is one of these glands that makes you feel good when you're just doing nothing. And it might be, I'm not saying it is, but it might be that some people in the world don't want us to feel good by just doing nothing. They want us to be out there being active every day, working hard and being busy. Mm. So we don't have time to think too much about what's going on.
Yeah.
So again, you know, these belief systems are very important. Do you want me to quickly recap
on just the first few?
You're jumping. You're also videoing it, so you can always watch that. Okay, so on this next page, I just want to highlight a lot of the unknown things about this world that scientists will probably never be able to prove with their experiments, but can add to your belief systems and to know what's really true. So I'm just going to read them out. Sixth sense, extrasensory perceptions, instinct, feelings, spirits, dreams, the unknown, unprovable, visions, voices, deja vu, eternal soul. Question mark. So I don't know if anyone would like to say anything about these unknowns or whether I'm incorrect that maybe the scientists will one day just come up with a formula and explain it all the way with their methods. Could probably just move on. Just to say, just to make the point that there's a lot of things just unknown.
Yeah.
A lot of mysteries out there.
Yeah.
Okay, our reality in 2014, as my dad used to say to me, get in the real world, Stephen. And what he meant by that was get a job, earn as much money as possible, and you'll have a happy life. I do believe that we're currently in a crisis point in the world where it's sort of a make or break time. What are we going to do in the future? Are we going to carry on raping the world of all its resources? Can we not see where that's going to end? The world is rife with killing, lying, cheating, disease, stealing, hate, envy, greed, and more. It's getting worse if we don't change soon. There obviously are good things out there too, and we need to be positive and everything else, but I think we are in a very special time, and this isn't to be ignored. Even if we're living in England and it actually seems very peaceful outside, we do know that in other places of the world it's actually very horrible, as we hear it on the news. We often want to ignore it, put it away, because perhaps we can't do anything about it, but you know, perhaps we can, because change is really in us. We can all make that decision to make a change. Any questions about that?
No, it's not correct.
Thought correct.
So on a more positive note, good. It's what I often used to say to myself, instead of saying God, because I was a bit confused about religion and what it says in the Bible, so I used to substitute the word good for God and just think of something that was all good.
Yeah.
Jesus said, love your enemy. Any of us tried that? And do you think it works?
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Do you get this really nice feeling afterwards and the problem just seems to have gone?
Forgiveness is very powerful.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And unforgiveness is even worse.
Exactly, it's the absolute opposite.
In the other way, yeah.
Falling out with a friend, or, you know. And the neighbour thing too, you know, the neighbours is probably sometimes one of the hardest, because you're in the close proximity, they build a bungalow on your land and ticks you off.
You spoiled my orchard.
You can't seem to get that. To get that over it.
The tower of trees, I don't like bungalows on it.
But in a way, what you can always do, you know, when I'm loving my enemies, say I'm kind of just, I almost think of them all the way back to when they were a little child.
Yeah.
And just think of, you know, what they've been through and everything, and it's not really
their fault.
But it's just the fact that it's not really their fault. They don't mean to be like them. And then it seems quite easy to let them off and think, well, actually, in the grand scheme of things, how much does it matter?
You know, the Quakers, that's basically how the Quakers think, isn't it? In the sense of,
well, there's goodness in everybody, and it's just finding it and using it.
Actually, there's a very old meeting house in Cornwall, which is called Come to God.
Right.
Yeah.
I think you mention God usually, and people will just straight away. Yeah. I don't believe in God because you know he flooded the earth and killed everyone. It's just because what's in the Bible.
Yeah.
It's just a book.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Mm.
It's been translated many times, and there's a lot of wisdom in there, but there's also some errors. And if there's even one error, then you don't know what to do with it. Jehovah's Witnesses, they believe in every single word of the Bible, don't they? And I think that's where they fall over. Why can't they just take the bits they like? Mm-hmm. They won't allow themselves to do that. So this is where we get on to this thing, which is what I've been experimenting, I'd say, for a good while. Nature provides all we need to live. Be natural, only consume natural, let nature take its course. Mm. So just on this point about being as natural as we can be, and it's my belief, and quite firm belief now, that anything natural is from the Creator, God, whatever made this universe and all its laws, and so it's going to be good for me. Except if I'm being silly and just going out and shoving loads of things in my mouth, which I don't understand. If I don't fully understand what's into them, like mushrooms, you don't fully understand how that mushroom was grown, what was in the ground to make that mushroom grow, so you've got to be careful.
Mm.
Same with berries. And I do think it's a bit crazy that if you look, probably 90% of the trees that grow around here are not beneficial. It could be so much better. And we know man has had quite a big influence on what trees are growing. So that isn't necessarily fully natural. It hasn't been allowed to take its natural course, and just, you know, these things would take time. If you took your garden and just did nothing with it, it might take 100 years before it got back into some sort of fully natural state. You'd probably get a period where it was just completely full of weeds. And maybe the worst type of weed, maybe bindweed or something like that.
Mm.
But who's to know that in a few years, because it's so predominant, it would get a disease and completely die out and not come back. And that would allow some other plant, some beneficial plant, to start to establish. And when that establishes, it spreads, and you'd eventually end up, possibly, I'm not saying definitely, with a little Garden of Eden.
Mm.
But that could take some time. So you've got to be careful when you think what is natural, what is completely untainted, what does come from God. But anything that is natural, I believe, would be good for you. And that's my firm belief. And on the flip side of that, anything which has had man's influence has the potential to harm you. Yes.
I have a question, Stephen. Have you always been natural since you were little, or is it something happens in your life that triggers you to change that?
No, I've always had a natural part in me. I'm half Norwegian. My mother is Norwegian.
Mm-hmm.
And for 6 weeks of every year we would go to Norway, and we'd go to the beach every day, or we'd be in the woods, and we'd walk up mountains, and so I had a deep love of Norway is very much more natural, although because it's such a northern country, there's usually only two of everything.
Mm-hmm.
Two types of trees that can grow. Two types of fish. Two types of berries. Well, they have a few more berries, but yeah, and, you know, to go and pick the raspberries and the blueberries, and you know, we really, really loved that. So mm-hmm. I had this deep, and so I saw the contrast with England. You know, where I wouldn't want to pick the blackberries off the side of the road because mm-hmm. well, they're darkened with soot or whatever. When we had leaded petrol, but now these days you can't really see it, but you'd probably think that they're there. So, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
It's always been in there for me, so I'm quite fortunate, I guess. Yeah. And I wanted to hold on to that.
Mm-hmm.
Let nature take its course is kind of a bit different. But, I mean, there's... I could probably go on about this page for quite a while, and if you've got any more questions, please raise your hand and I'll and say them. For example, I was talking earlier with someone, you know, who says it's always good to be positive, isn't it? Well, it's certainly better than always being negative. But aren't you sort of, you're trying to sort of force something, you're trying to sort of say, I'm going to be positive, I'm going to make this good. Whereas I think, and maybe faith comes into this a bit, you know, just allow things to happen the way they naturally should. And Bruce Lee said this too when he was teaching his craft. He said he never, when he was starting a fight, he never predicted the outcome of the fight. He would let nature take its course. And that's how he was able to react just naturally and normally win the fight. Not that I'm suggesting we should be out there fighting, just an example. That here we're at the end of part one, at least with my pages. I don't know what time, I don't think we've been going that long.
It's about
20 to 8?
Yeah.
Well, you know. So I think if you've got any questions on that, if you could can hear them, and if not, maybe have a short pee break and a cup of coffee or whatever we've got available. I'm not sure what's available.
There's tea and coffee and biscuits. Please help yourself.
Oh, very nice.
And there's plates here, so just help yourself.
I'm going to play you some of these.
So do help yourself.
Thank you very much.
I put the water in for you, and then you can
talk
about
like trees.
I remember, you know, we often had
lots of it, like we should be better.
We do.
Yeah, and also in human history, yeah. They've taken examples of animals, saying, oh, look at this animal, it does that. Mm-hmm. We should do that too.
Yes.
So we're almost copying the animals rather than being master of the animals.
To be here, it's at least a quarter of a
sense.
No, it's good. Yeah, it's a good question. Actually, there will be things in part two. Which
Steve, would you like
a
coffee? Still happy with your rainbow? Are you
having
coffee?
I'm actually not too lazy.
Yeah,
because you said you got
some. Yeah, I am. Yeah,
I'll try.
There's chamomile, there's green tea.
Yeah, it helps yourself. If you want to, take a plate for it, but what did you do?
Yes, that's what I thought.
And then you can sit and listen to Stephen and the others.
Yeah, I'm just going to have some boiled water.
Is that all you need to
have? Help yourself, you've got peppermint, you've got green tea.
Coffees
from different parts of the world and different teams. Yeah, we have fair trade. Well, we just have the whole Thursday, Friday, Saturday daytime.
Well,
if you like that, I'll give you a
link. Insight
tells you.
That's great, it's really good. Sorry, I was late. I'm busters again, but they've been running late on the other one. I've just come for another.
At least you've turned up. Yeah, which is that?
No, no, it's exclusive. No, I wouldn't have missed it.
Thank you.
Stephen, have some biscuits?
I have had one. We're going very deep. potentially as well.
Yeah, I've known her back a long, long time. Well,
lots of my friends have been back for a long time, and then he met somebody else, which I'm
afraid. He still wouldn't want to leave.
You know, they made
Artichoke and
then
sweet
you
potato.
Do that,
oh, it's a real winner.
I'm talking average 70.
And
tummy.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. 90%
at the very end.
Yeah. So the average.
See, actually, we all said he looked well.
Yeah.
You know?
Someone has been had it for years.
Yeah. Sometimes it's good to let me
dancing.
But I bet you
no, it wouldn't be.
Last time I saw you,
no.
Yesterday,
you know,
they
were expected.
Yeah,
you
know,
had one of the people, we could
help them. Yeah, well, I mean, it wasn't anything, it was just a nice size. Yeah. Yeah. Sometimes you think, well, it's a birthday party, you don't want to do it today, because then you need so many people to get the atmosphere. This is great.
Simon, the bell has rung.
That's okay, that's
good. Did you stop recording?
No, it's always going on. So you can remember the conversation. Right. Sorry about this. Part two. Okay, this part is going to get, like I say, this is come from somebody else's information, but it's sat very well with what I've been discussing already, and it adds a lot of things that we looked at on the unknown page, all the unknown things. So there's going to be, if you like, in this part, there's going to be a lot of statements that you're going to find quite shocking, in a sense, to take on. So I'm not asking you to believe everything I say, but maybe just have an open mind to its possibility. And I would call this part, How to Avoid Descending Deeper into the Hells and instead ascend through the spiritual realms and get closer to our true Creator God. So, when I say the hells, we're not talking about hell and a burning pit, but we're talking about areas in your own mind which may not be pleasant. Maybe a place where you have hate, fear, or any of these perhaps unwanted and negative emotions. I just want to state clearly that this isn't a religion. All religions and churches have errors. I've written here the Rosetta Stone. This is because while I was writing this, I woke up one morning and the Rosetta Stone, it was for some reason, it was just repeating in my head, so I looked it up. Of course, it's the tablet where you had three different languages, ancient Egyptian, Greek and some other language, and they were all saying the same thing. So the Rosetta Stone was how they could understand what the Egyptian hieroglyphics meant. But if we look at what it actually says, it's very interesting indeed, because it's basically a deal between the priesthood at the time and the King Ptolemy, or however you say that, that said the priesthood wouldn't have to pay any taxes if they celebrated the days of the birthdays of the king and the king's favourite days, and they would actually also worship the king. So I think that's a very telling point in history when, if you like, the powers that be, those who are sort of above us all, kind of made a sneaky little deal, which I think was a bit naughty, really. I don't know what anyone else thinks about that, or if you understand what I'm saying. But it's not the main thing, but I think, you know, this is where God gets a bad name because of religion and how the churches use Jesus or use whoever to get people to kind of form in line. And that's something you can take a look. New Age spirituality and old are well-meaning but are limited by their exclusion of God as an entity, as a being. I believe that all our souls put together was God. And that's kind of what I believed. And, you know, maybe it doesn't make any difference, but maybe it does. And when we get on to some of the things I'm going to talk about, knowing the correct truth can make all the difference in the world. So if God was a being, a single being that created the souls that we have. He might not like it if we just think he's not that, or he, she is not that. And we might not get the right feelings from God that could help us. Okay, I didn't need to spend too long on this. It was basically just to say that this isn't another religion, what we're about to. Okay, so from these other teachings, it says, I can tell you, what we are is a soul created by God. Now, at conception, when my mother and father conceived me, a soul was waiting there ready. And actually, it split in half. And half of the soul got attached to my body, which was created by my mother and father. And they also, or kind of you say with the help of God, created a spirit body. So actually, I've got a physical body, I've got a spirit body, which is currently in the same place as my physical body, and I've got my half soul, which is here too, but there we go. And somewhere else, may have been a year later, may have been at the same time, but at some point the other half of the soul went and got attached to somebody else being conceived. And if you like, this was God's plan, this is how he kind of designed it, to get attached to a physical body, a spirit body, and another half soul. So each half of the soul has two bodies, a spirit and a physical. Now, so this to me, when I first heard this, was okay. I've always sort of felt I can be complete just in myself. You know, I didn't necessarily like this, what was being told to me. I have an open mind, and I can allow it to sort of sit there for a bit. And I was just walking to the shops, and so I just had that feeling, okay, so God has designed me, the half of my soul, and I have the other half of me, what I think of as me, that bit that cannot cease to exist. He's designed it, you know, me to come into contact with it at some point. And I got the most amazing feeling come through me. Now, I've experienced these feelings before, and they're difficult to describe. You can say it's tingles down your spine, but if you get it, you know it, and there's nothing else like it. It feels beautiful. I can feel a little bit now. It's very, very lovely. So I know it. And also, the other information, we'll get onto that in a bit, is this is how you can prove to yourself what's true and what's not true. If you're in this position where you're ready to accept this sort of feeling, you can ask a question if you like, and if you feel nothing. I think I may have turned away from it or was on another subject, and for the next 3 days I wasn't feeling too good. I wasn't really getting anything, I wasn't feeling great, and I thought, oh, I've been holding on to an error. And as soon as I kind of let go of that error and let this new truth in, I got the feelings again. I know I'm on the right track again. Okay? So does anyone like to ask a question about this?
I'm just first of all going to ask, what does it unique want?
Soul.
One unique soul. I couldn't say it.
Bending.
So do we have to go and find this other half of
not
the
really
soul?
No, you don't have to try and do anything, because it's being designed, you allow things to happen, so don't try and intellectualize anything. It will come. So I am on the soulmates, because it's quite a big thing to think you have a soulmate. And, you know, some people may have, or most, right, in most cases, if you're like hoping to find your soulmate, which we all should, because, you know, it'd be great, wouldn't it? So most of the time, your soulmate would have come in contact in your life with you, probably from quite a young age. We're capable of meeting our soulmates, you know, quite young. It might not always be the case, but it might be. They will usually have helped you in your life, or you'll find when you come into contact with them, they are helpful, and they never sort of criticise you, really. They're always that kind of that friendly, you know, if you're going down a bad track, they're probably going down a bad track too. So you're both going down a bad track. And when you're doing better, they're doing better too. So they're kind of, it's you. It's the other half of you. And you can, you know, you can know it by feeling and you don't have to rush it. But the other thing is that as you get closer to God, this automatically draws you to your soulmate. So you may walk past your soulmate in the street and not even acknowledge them, but that would be if you were really not going, if you were not ascending, if you were descending, you could just miss it completely because you're thinking about some other rubbish that you would need to be thinking about. Right, so I'm talking about here two things, the sleep state and the spiritual realm. So if you like, this, I mean, that soulmate information seemed quite new to you, or, you know, maybe you've heard, we've all heard of soulmate, we've seen the yin and yang symbol, but maybe not heard that, what, we're just half a soul. No, I'd never heard that before.
No.
And so here's another bit of information there. I've never heard before. That struck me as quite compelling. The sleep state. As our physical body rests, our spirit body continues existing in the spirit realm. Now, we remember the odd dreams usually, and a dream is something different from sleep state. So if I say dream, what we're talking about is the soul is trying to give you a message. Whereas sleep state is what you're continually existing from the moment you go to sleep to the moment you wake up. And I think we've probably all had an experience where we're waking up in the morning, we're kind of remembering a dream, and it seemed to go back we were there for quite a long time. That is probably you in your sleep state. And so you can get an idea of how well you're doing by what was in your sleep state. You know, was it dark? Was it scary? Did you wake up in sweats or unhappy? You know, that would indicate not a great place. Was it sunny and you were having fun? And yeah, then you're in a quite good place, so you can think, well, I'm probably doing quite well. The other thing about the sleep state is I definitely remember dreams where it's like, I know the place. It's like a city or another world, but I know it. I know where things are. And so that would be kind of your area. So we don't get to choose too much where we're put. We're put where we can feel comfortable. Or if we are someone who's full of hate or anything else, the only place we can really be is also somewhere else full of hate, because nobody else would want us in their realm. So the better you get, you're going to be around better people, and then the ones full of hate can't come near you, they can't. Now, from these teachings, the first realm of the spirit world, like spirit world, the place where we go, the first realm is subdivided probably in like thousands of levels. So when I mentioned the hells is obviously in the lowest part. Now, the way the spirit world works is it gets bigger as more spirits are filling it up. So that's why the first realm is so big, because most of us are there. Probably 99.99% of us on Earth are within this first realm. You can be right to the top, which they apparently they call Summerland, which is a pretty good place, probably, you know, better than Earth, nice things around. But down here, where spirits are full of hate and unfortunately they continue to do bad things, they continue to try and influence us all the time to do bad things, and even now perhaps what's going on in the world, killing people and things like that. And they can get in such a bad condition that they become unrecognizable as human, and that's where someone might call them a deep. Okay, but here's some good news after telling you that. Remember I said the soul is attached to the body when you're conceived. So a miscarriage, if you have a miscarriage, that tiny little fetus goes off into the spirit world. But apparently they get looked after until they're sort of a baby or one in this nice area, and then they go to where all the other children would go when they die, a nice area where they're allowed to do what they want, they're quite happy, and they start achieving, going higher levels. So this to me is, you know, something we can understand. It may sound like a bit of a computer game thing with levels, because it does go on to say about level 2, level 3 and higher. But it's something we can understand. Whereas before it's always been, what happens, you know, if we say with reincarnation, I always believed in reincarnation. But you know, so what happened to those great people like Elvis or Gandhi? What, they just fizzle out of existence? They get reborn as something else and they forget, you know, because if we've been reincarnated, why can't we remember all those lives we had? It starts to make sense, and it starts to actually make life a bit more serious as well, what we're doing, and you know, makes being good feel a lot more important. Because if we don't do it now in our physical life, we've still got to do it when we pass, and it's harder afterwards because you're going to get more influenced by these bad spirits. Hey, come on, we've got 24-hour parties. Let's go from this party to that party. Influence people to drink more alcohol, smoke more drugs, and have more sex so that they can kind of share in that experience. They're still addicted to all these things, so they're kind of encouraging us to go down the bad route. But luckily, there's also spirits who have ascended higher through the levels that will help us. And apparently, we all have a spirit guide and a guardian, so these may be jobs that we get after we pass. We might get a job as a guardian for someone, and we'd want to help through love, and that may help us also go through. I don't know, because I haven't really been there. But what I have been doing since I heard this information is really looking into what I'm dreaming. Now, I did smoke quite a bit of cannabis. I didn't smoke that much, but I smoked it every day. And one thing cannabis does is it, you know, you really don't remember your dreams. But I kind of could remember them. So I was actually realising I was doing some quite bad things in my sleep state. I haven't had sex with a woman for about 7 years. And I've also pretty much, I can not masturbate. I'm not looking at porn or anything like that. So, but I'm kind of depriving myself from a pleasure. But what I was doing in my sleep state is I was compensating. And I found out just by one night, so I was nodding off, and then there were three naked girls there. Within a moment, I was there. That's what I was going to probably do all night. And probably, you know, with anyone. So there was no sort of real love. It wasn't like I was searching for my soulmate to have sex with. You know, I thought my beliefs were like, doesn't matter what I do in my sleep. And now when I'm thinking, actually, it does matter what I do in my sleep. If I want to be better in the day to achieve a higher level, I don't want them to go and ruin it in my sleep state. So, as soon as I was conscious of it, in my dreams then, I wasn't doing that. I was driving my car. I was travelling somewhere. I remember pulling over, looking at a map, I was driving somewhere. And then I was having this dream, I was trying to drive over this bridge, but it, you know, I couldn't get over it and things like that. And And I thought, right, I'm going to stop smoking cannabis because I really want to hear my dreams. I really want to know what's going on again. And that I know, because even it was hard for me even to go a day without cannabis. You know, I'd usually probably put a little bit in a cigarette sort of at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, you know, to take away all the problems of the world as I thought I was doing. So even the first day was hard, but that first night I had some intense dreams. And I would say they were dreams rather than my sleep state. They'd been probably queuing up a lot of things I needed to hear. So I had 3 or 4 days of some amazing intense dreams, and I was really enjoying them. So there was no need for me then to want cannabis, because then I was just looking forward to the next night when I had my dreams. And also after about 3 days, it's not like as addictive as tobacco. It wasn't really that difficult to give up. So, and I noticed when, you know, I was traveling in my car and then Francis was with me, and I hadn't really often had Francis, my son Francis, 7 years old, he's probably in a pretty good place. Suddenly I was now perhaps in a better state so that I could actually share some time with my son. And also my brother and my dad, I was with them a bit more, and it was lighter, it was brighter, because I also remember a lot of my dreams in the past has quite often been dark. But now it was sunny, it was bright, feeling much better. I believe just by consciously wanting to know, I've now been able to improve my sleep state. And the other night, I was talking to this Indian guy about God and saying something about emotions. And, you know, so now even my sleep state, I'm trying to improve my thing by helping and being loving. So that's something we can all experiment with. We just have to have the conscious desire to want to know what we're like in our sleep state, and the desire to want to improve and go up rather than down. I'll just say something quickly about some of the other levels beyond. Apparently, to get into level 3, you have to tell the truth all the time, which is, you know, is going to be quite tough if we think about it. But it's quite comforting to know as well, if you ever got contacted by a spirit from level 3, can't lie. But hey, if you ever get contact from spirits in the lower levels, there's nothing stopping them from lying. And that's the other thing, you know, my dad has just passed over. And of course I've had a good cry about it because I'm going to miss him and everything. But it's much more comforting to know that, you know, he is still there. And apparently when people die, so the physical body, just like when you're asleep, but now it's permanently out of action, the spirit body now, and they usually remain on the earth for about 40 days, and then they would go permanently into their place in the spirit world. But many of them don't. Many of them stay on the earth because they're addicted to things on the earth, and they don't need sleep, they don't need to eat, so they can just go around 24 hours a day, and again, not thinking. Because when I showed you the first bit about what we are, spirit body, physical body, soul, our physical brain is mainly in control of our physical body. Mm-hmm. And our intellect is probably more in our spirit brain. So the spirit body has organs as well, and chakra points. And the soul also has organs, which we'll get onto in a bit. Level 8 is apparently oneness with God. And level 6 is as far as you can get without taking on God. And apparently Buddha is still on level 6. There's apparently a lot of souls still on level 6 because they don't believe in God. Even though they've died and they're carrying on, they don't believe in God. This is the information I've received, which I'm sharing with you. Mm-hmm. And I didn't remember, I said at the start, there's a lot to kind of take on. But don't worry, I will let you know the source of it eventually. Before the Before the end. Okay, so is there any other questions about this? Or things you'd like to say?
I'd like to say, I just don't get it at all.
What don't you get?
No, any of all that.
Any of what I said?
Yes, it just, I just,
Okay.
I've heard of, say that you evolve from one, as you say, from one plane to another. I've heard of that saying, you know, you must evolve after you're sort of passed on. The saying, you come back so many times in reincarnation to experience certain things. Once you've experienced this, you might then go on to a higher level, or a higher plane, when you've died.
Yeah, but so what you say, yes, you're saying, you know, you still kind of want reincarnation.
Yeah.
And
I thought that was what.
And you're happy with that thought.
Yeah.
And you don't want this to be true because it's different. Mm. And but this is what I mean. I don't want you to accept this right now. Mm. We've talked about seeds and fertile ground before. So allow it something you can mull over and think about. And I will at the end give you the source where you can go and, you know, hear where these teachings are coming from, and there's a heck of a lot more. You know, this is quite a new thing for me. This happened between the time that I decided to do this talk. It was actually 2 or 3 days before I went on holiday. I got to hear about as much as you'll probably hear tonight. And I went away on holiday for 2 weeks, and I was thinking about it, So, okay, this gets quite technical, but the simplistic thing about, you know, when we sleep, we continue, we don't stop. If we don't remember anything in our dreams, it's probably because we don't want to. We want to block it up. In our day-to-day lives, we put on clothes, but you know, we also put on a face and then maybe a bit of an act, and we can call that the facade.
Mm-hmm.
But in our sleep state, we don't, there's no point. We are just ourselves, we do what we want. And that might be why if you're struggling to remember anything that's happening in the night, that you just don't want to know. That you actually, you're sort of slightly in denial. But I don't want to be negative, but you know, the facts are that, like, if we go back to part one of the talk, the world is in a pretty shitty place.
Mm-hmm.
And we might, you know, like I realised what I was doing, I realised I was doing myself no good,
mm-hmm.
and I wanted to change it. And it's not that difficult when you know.
Yeah. But sometimes you wake up and you don't realise, you know, you can't remember anything that you dreamt about.
Mm.
Yeah. But other times something's very vivid.
Very
and
nice.
Almost
yeah.
sort of wanted to go back into that.
Yeah.
Sort of
yeah.
Dream
yeah.
World.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
No, I do. That bit I know and experience,
yeah.
but I don't quite. Anyway, that doesn't matter. It might be that my ground just isn't quite fertile enough at the moment.
If it's funny, then remember. If it's humorous, I always remember if it's funny. Funny joke. I've got funny, you know, like a funny dream.
Mm.
This dream's got some humour to it. Made you laugh. You woke up laughing.
That's a very good sign, though, you see. You wake up laughing. I had a dream the other night where I live in a house which is attached to two others, and the neighbours in the middle we find a bit difficult to get on with, but a friend of mine from school is on the one in the end. And in my dream there are no walls. And me and my friend were just finding it so funny, and we were having such a good laugh. Yeah, wake up laughing. And that's a great sign.
Mm.
Again, but if you woke up in sweats and You know, that's a sign that you need to do something, you need to act if you want to change it.
Mm.
Like the dream, I had a dream when I was younger, my teeth were falling out in the dream, and I woke up, oh, phew, it's only a dream.
Mm.
Yeah.
Now I look back on that and think, well, there's a sign, I was probably going into some naughty things at the age of 13, 14, and the dream was actually my sleep state worsening.
Mm.
It's quite a common thing to have, isn't it?
It is.
Falling out.
It is. Very common. Okay, so now I just want to talk a bit more about the soul, which is the important thing. And you know, the soul is, there's the spirit body and the physical body. The physical body's only got a lifetime of 100 years. The spirit body may have a lifetime of several hundred thousand years. But essentially, it's the soul that was created by God. It's our souls, which is that me inside of us that doesn't want to cease to exist. And as I said, it has organs. So the soul has a mind, but it's the smallest and most unimportant organ in the soul. And it's basically where the belief systems that you hold will be stored. And that's basically what it is. So a bit of intellect in the soul. The soul does have a bit of intellect, but just a bit. The next one would be is humility. So this is about just being your soul. No facade, nothing else, just be yourself. And you will know this, you will say exactly what you think all the time. You won't care what people think of you, you'll just do it. And to be that humble, to be in that humility, then allows, if you like, access to the heart of the soul, which is the most powerful bit. And apparently I heard someone say, or the person given this information say, I'm not sure if it was when the soul is together, but that the soul is as powerful or more powerful than the sun. That's the, if you like, the potential of our soul. It's got real power, but you need to feel it. There's no words involved at all, it needs to be felt. Then we've got emotions, which I'll probably go into, So the emotions part and the affection part. I don't know if it's exactly like this. It's probably not this shape. It's probably got loads more. Apparently it's more complex than the universe. And the universe is actually quite simple. But the soul is bloody complex and amazing and fantastic. And you can't really explain what it is because it's all feeling.
Mm.
Yeah, so the soul is all feeling. And here are just some things that would be associated with the soul. Your beliefs, your passions, your desires, your emotions, your intentions, your memories, your experiences. So that's all soul stuff. Truth and error cannot coexist on a specific subject. So the soul is not capable of storing an error and a truth at the same time on a specific subject. So you can't believe that God is an entity and God is all our souls put together. You cannot have that in your soul, it cannot happen. So in order for me to I need to be able to release the error of me thinking that all our souls together are God. In order to do that, I need to kind of go back in my mind when I first thought that and start to realize, why did I think that? Was it spirit influence from these spirits who can't get past the sixth sphere? Very likely. And I need to start thinking, well, more, you know, thinking, feeling as well, but then start thinking, well, you know, God is an entity. I guess he could make a shooting star just appear right in the sky that I'm looking at when I have a certain thought. Because this has happened to me quite a lot. I'll have a thought, and if it's a true thought, a shooting star comes. One occasion I was 20 years old, I was wondering what to do in my life. I thought, I'll go to Norway and go in their army because I had the opportunity. I'll do it. I'm going to do that. Shooting star. So, and that's happened. It's happened other times. It's happened more recently with some things which I may go into. So I started to think, well, actually, now, if God was made up of all souls, how would it manage to do that? It's a bit trickier, it seems. But if God was a being, an entity, he'd be able to do that so easily. Then I'm starting to accept the, you know, the different sort of thing into my soul, and the more truth you get into your soul, the better you're going to do. Is it? Did anyone not follow that? Am I being clear?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. So first release the error, then you can absorb the truth. And it's also quite comforting, because once you've got a truth in your soul, it's going to be very, very difficult to remove it.
Mm.
The soul is dominant over both our bodies. Now this is where it comes into healing. Because if there's an error, if there's a problem with your soul, eventually it's going to show either in the spirit body or then eventually the physical body. And that's the last chance. And this is kind of where I came in with the healing. Because I've been researching herbs. I've probably tried every single herb there is, and I've still got conditions. I've got these flat warts on my hand, which I started thinking about the other day. I think I know the source of the problem. So it's more about my actions and what I'm doing in life. I had this affliction on my face, which, although it was much, much worse before, you know, it still, you know, still sometimes plays up. And I believe that has some issue to do with my thoughts on women, because I certainly did. A year, 2 years ago, I was getting to the point where I think, I just hate all women. All women are so stupid. They don't know anything, right? That's what I was thinking. So, you know, and that's obviously an error. Well, I'll ask the women, that's obviously an error.
Obviously.
I was thinking, when did they? I mean, they're not that bad. You don't really. No one really knows. Apart from if I've had got them wet, washing up, bath, they tend to sort of glow a bit more. So then I'm looking and thinking, what the hell is it? And I was thinking, well, you know, did it start with drinking rainwater? Or was it when I was eating dandelion leaves? And then I was thinking, no, this started when I started getting housing benefit, right? Because my earnings went quite low, and I went across to the council and they offered me some housing benefit. Now, this is going to be on camera, but I'm going to be honest. Occasionally I get a cash drop, and I don't declare that. Now, partly this kind of my dad, he's always said, Don't, Stephen, you don't need to tell them. Just get as much money as you can. Forget, you know, if they help them, do take it, right? But I almost forgot. I was doing that, and I completely forgot about it, really. I hadn't remembered. So this is reminding me. So I've written a note in my diary, because we're a bit busy at the moment, so after this stuff is done, I'm going to do my tax return and declare every single cash job I've got. I'll probably then go and be a bit more the truth about every expense I've got. And I did start a second business at the time, so if my tax bill's too high, I don't want to pay tax. But I realised, you know, here I'm being a bit dishonest. And the warts haven't gone yet, I haven't done the action, but I'll find out. I've got a good feeling that's the case.
Mm.
So we'll see. Progress by feeling all pleasure and pain. So this is about, if you want to progress, just allow everything to happen. And if it's painful, go for it. Allow it. You know, I still smoke tobacco. I'm cutting down. I've been having about 4 or 5 a day, except yesterday when I smoked about 15. And I drank about 10 beers as well, so that was a special occasion yesterday.
Mm.
So when if I refuse myself a cigarette, or I run out of cigarettes and I'm not going to the shop to buy more, I feel quite painful. I feel this fear that, can I live without cigarettes forever? And you know, so, but I'm improving, and that, you know, and I've been playing this song, I don't know if you heard the lyrics, take your time, go slowly. don't be harsh on yourself. I could go and run off into the woods, be away from cigarettes and 50 miles away from any shop, but that would be quite unloving to myself. So, you know, just as long as you make an improvement, you're better than you were yesterday, and you keep it up, you know, then it's okay, isn't it? Suppress one emotion and all will be suppressed. And a lot of people, and myself included, when I was first hearing this, I was thinking, I don't feel any emotions really, I'm pretty much like this all the time. And I was quite happy to be like that. I thought that was probably quite good. You know, at least I'm not manic depressive thinking. You know?
Oh, okay.
But really, I would like to feel some happiness. That would actually be nice. I would like some joy. I would like these good emotions. So if I'm kind of suppressing some fear and I'm just putting it to the side and I'm not ignoring it, then, you know, then I'm not going to be feeling much. So, like I say, this, you know, this is some complicated stuff. And the guy I got the information from, he is, he's done something like 800 hours you could listen to if you wanted. But it can get quite painful. So it's probably best to sort of keep things simple and just go day by day and see what happens. So you start to feel. Because we just had a few in my dad's time, we did have good cry, a really good cry, and you know, after that, certainly did feel quite a bit better. And then I had a real moment with my older brother last night. The happiness was just awesome. It was just so amazing. I haven't felt like that, I don't think, since I was about 1 year old. And this is the feeling I got, my older brother, hugging my older brother, and it was bringing me back to that time in my life, and the happiness was just—it was almost frightening. But I, because I've had this information, I'm starting to understand it, and I was just letting it happen, and it was absolutely beautiful. Now I'll just—I don't know if I say this on the next page or not, but I'm just going to say it. One of the issues that we've got is when we're born, our soul is not in a perfect state. And we don't have much control over our lives the first 2 or 3 years. And that's where a lot of the damage gets done and remains, unless we're able to go back and sort of forgive the errors that our parents put onto us with their emotional problems, which was put onto them by their parents, and we go back. If we go back a few generations, especially in England, you know, the empire, you know, we're basically broken in like horses. So that is the way to get rid of these emotions, is to forgive what others have done to us and then repent what we've done to others. And I think my dad was actually, with me in particular, kind of let me do what I want a lot of the time, I think, when I was a lot younger. I'm certainly have been like that with my son, so I might have more to repent and to actually forgive. But, you know, everyone's lived their own life. Mm. The memories are all there. It's just not so easy to jump straight back to when you're 1 year old. You can't. Okay? But last night, just through, I wasn't trying, it was just happening, I suddenly got this feeling of, this was an old memory, this is how I'm hugging my older brother. And, you know, something after that, it felt like something kind of was undone and felt much, much better.
Mm-hmm.
So it doesn't have to be complicated, but it is quite a large thing to kind of take on. It can seem enormous. And I'll just say the thing with fear, the other thing I did when I first heard about this, I was going to sleep and I was like, okay, trying to, I say it in words, but sometimes you can say it in words and that brings the feeling. God, please can you show me some, you know, one of my fears. I want to face one of my fears. And straight away, it was your mum, so my mumur, my Norwegian grandma, and I had an issue with her. I think she couldn't really speak English, there wasn't much communication, and, you know, she was an old lady, you know, in my opinion at the time, quite ugly. Then suddenly, because also when she died, I didn't go to her funeral, and I had this dream afterwards, and it was scary, it was like her ghost. Straight away, I felt this fear, and I could see the house, I was there in the house, it felt really scary. I was upstairs in the loft bit, and then, felt really scary, but instead of pushing it away and waking up and thinking about something else, so I didn't have to think about it anymore, I was a little bit brave, and I went for it. It didn't actually last that long, and probably the worst part of it was just before deciding you're actually going to feel it.
Mm-hmm.
And as soon as then, you know, the fear wasn't that scary, but I kind of let it go,
mm-hmm.
let the motion go, emotion move, allowed it, and I would say that was, you know, part of me understanding how to progress. And there's probably other fears I have, I'm sure there's, apparently we probably have loads and loads and loads, but if we just kind of allow things to happen day by day, slowly they'll come up here and there and deal with them and improve our state. I'm sure I can see questions buzzing in the mind, but we're nearly at the end. In fact, this is the second to last page. God's truth is the only truth, the absolute truth. You will feel it when it enters your soul. And I was talking earlier about that tingling. And if you've ever had any sort of such feeling, it's unique. You know there's nothing else that feels the same. God's, and also, you know, I was going to say something, no, forget it. God's love, when received fully, will enter the heart of your soul. You will sob and cry, but also be filled with joy. God loves all of us all of the time. So God is our true mum and dad. And if you take the soul, you know, the soul is two parts, male and female. So God is our mum and our dad. So you're my sister, in reality, from a soul's perspective. You created my body and my spirit body, but my soul is. You didn't make that. And your parents didn't make your soul. God made your soul. So God is our mum and our dad, and we're all children of God. And they love us all the time. They never stop loving us. We put the barriers up. We turn it off. We've got free will. And that's the only way we're going to learn, isn't it?
Mm.
So feeling, when you want to know the truth, there's a way of knowing the truth. And if you want to ask God what it's like to feel His love, you can do that. And you can, but you have to want it from the heart. You have to feel that you want it. This information, part two, most of it, all the new information I'd never heard before, was provided by Alan J. Miller, an Australian. He and his soulmate were the first soul from Earth to reach a spiritual realm where the soul fully reunites and can reincarnate. Or reincarnation is possible. They're on divinetruth.com. There's a Divine Truth channel on YouTube, which is where there's this 800 hours worth of videos if you want to watch. They talk to spirits in the spirit realm, try and help them. They do seminars. There's also interviews that they've done with the public. And he says he was Jesus in his first life, which is the massive pill that most people just cannot take on. But when you see the information that I've shown you, and I think it seems to have touched all of you, I think I have that feeling that this is possible. And it's, you know, it's not very important whether he was Jesus or not, but it does make it very interesting. Well, it makes it even more interesting because of this time we're in now in the world. And it makes sense to me because I'm thinking, right, God gave us free will. And you saw some mistakes and that they're getting passed down generations. It's not really our fault, is it, that we're being born with these issues that we don't understand at all. So he tweaked it a bit. And what A.J. Miller says is he was born as a normal person, but God took all the soul error away. So his soul was perfect. And then he lived his life accordingly. Of course, kid at school come and punch him in the face. He didn't do anything back because he was just so full of love. He understood punching him back wasn't going to help. You know, it wasn't his fault this kid did this. When he was in his 20s, a girl accused him of having sex with her and not wanting to marry her. And the family, the father and brothers, took him and they did this thing where they shove a spear through his arm into the ground where he can't move, and then kind of go in on him and break his arms and his legs, and brought him to the point near death where the girl came out and said, "No, stop, I made that up." So they let him go and he went and lived in a cave for 4 years where he noticed that he was healing. And that was the point where he became one with God, started going around talking to Peter and the disciples. But he didn't walk on water. He didn't turn water into wine. The Bible has embellished, bigged him up to make him this thing that we'll all worship. But he was spreading, if you look at what Jesus said, kind of ties in a lot with what he's still saying. Well, it does. But now he's actually here. He's able to give it to us, you know, descriptively and properly. But whether you want to take on that or not, or just stop at the point where I got to this page and just think about what I said about emotions and everything else, then that's probably fine. And I might be wrong, maybe he's not. Maybe he's just managed to tune into all this information. But I've had those feelings when I think about A.J. Miller. So I can't deny that and not deny the rest. So, that's kind of the end of the talk. I hope you found it interesting.
Very interesting.
Thank you
very much.
Thank you.
Yeah, very good.
Thank you.
Very thought provoking.
Yeah.
No, I thought so. I'll just add one more thing. So when I decided to do this talk and everything, I wanted to get some more inspiration. So I went outside. I had a feeling I should go outside and just look at the sky. I was going to have a cigarette at the same time, but I should go and look at the sky. And I just had this thought: heaven is coming to earth. Just made me think. And I saw the biggest shooting star of my life. And then a few days later, I was outside and I kind of had this theory that Nibiru is going, you know, Planet X, that's been on my mind for years. And so what I've been thinking lately is we seem to be getting quite a bit of space debris. It's like just clouds just seem to come out of nowhere. And I was looking up and this cloud was coming out of nowhere. And then it was changing form as they do. It was massive, but it looked exactly like Jesus on the cross, sort of head turned like that. But looked like his feet were like a dart coming in. He was coming. I make YouTube videos, and I made one called "Jesus is Coming." I've seen this club. And I suppose that prompted me to go and look for, is there anyone claiming to be Jesus? But yeah, that's how it came about that I looked into that. But and since then, you know, my life has just been improving all the time. I've just been loving it. And I was quite relieved to think that, no, I'm not Jesus, because I think everyone's often had this Messiah complex, not everyone, but I think you watch a film and you kind of put yourself in the place of the character. When I was 19, I had this thought, I worried that I was Jesus, and I kind of got over that. Difficult when you look like this and you're like, oh, Jesus! But no, it was also quite nice to think that I knew it wasn't me. And I also, because he did say there are seven others, as he got to this spiritual realm, they waited for a few others, or they'd been transcending the spiritual realms together. So there are seven other souls who reincarnated. So I then had thought, well, maybe I'm. That was when I was feeling not great for 3 days. I was thinking, maybe I'm one of these other souls, because I was born in 77, he was born in 52, was it 62? 62. And, but no, then I was feeling nothing for about 3 days. And then I thought, okay, I'm a new soul, just like 99.9% of everyone else. And then I felt it again, felt the happiness. And it works. I can do it now, even right now, when I've been saying it, I replicate the feelings. And I haven't smoked any drugs today, so. So yeah, that's so it works for me, and I think it could work for everyone. And it's good news, I'd say it's good news.
Tell me, when you were in the forces in Norway, how did you feel about that training and that general thing about training to kill people?
Yeah, I never wanted to kill anyone, I knew that, I was quite firm on that. Certainly didn't want to be killed either. So when I went, because I was thinking about going in the British Army, which was, you'd have to commit for 3 years, and there's a good chance you go to Northern Ireland. And actually, I remember when I was coming back from the Oxford session where I'd done the tests and everything, I was having some quite eerie feelings walking back from there, not very nice. So I kind of knew I wasn't going to do that. Then when the Norwegian one came up, there's a bit more of a challenge. Norway, much less likely to have a war. At that time, there didn't seem, it was like 1998, it didn't seem like there was really going to be wars breaking out. So I felt pretty confident that there wasn't going to be any war. But I learned to shoot a gun and everything, which I guess I enjoyed that. I don't.
But you're a pacifist, aren't you?
I am now. Yes. Knowing God's truth that there's never ever a reason to be violent towards anyone. And I've thought about that, and I've let that truth in. So now, you know, I've smacked my child before because I thought, well, that's the quickest way to get him to realise he's wrong. Give him a quick smack. And now I realise, actually, no, that is wrong, and I'm sorry for the times I did it, and I'm not going to do it again. And so, yeah, if someone comes up and punches me in the face, well, I'll wait and see if that happens. Hopefully it won't. But if what I've noticed, and throughout my life, and that hasn't happened to me very often, is if you're kind of, you're happy and you're all right with people, they're not likely to come back to your place.
Exactly. Is Alan J. Miller then, what era was he? Is he still around, or...?
Yeah, he's around. So he's doing this teaching.
Yes.
And whether this teaching is restricting him from actually progressing himself.
Right.
But he openly admits, you know, he hasn't reached that level where he was when he was Jesus. And what happened when he had problems when he was a kid. You know, him coming back was a real act of love towards us.
Yes.
And it wasn't until he was about 34. He'd had memories ever since he was 2 of other things.
Right.
So like me, I've never had any memories of before I was born. You know, I thought maybe I had, or I had a dream that I thought maybe that was from before in another life, but when I've analysed it, I didn't, but he did. And then when he was 30, 34, he had a week where he was just getting loads of them.
Yes.
And he came to the conclusion, because of all these memories he was getting, mm-hmm. of 2,000 years in the spirit realm, not all of it, because he's still getting more all the time. Mm.
Yeah.
And that life which he, you know, if he was remembering being up on a cross or whatever,
yes.
and in the specific things that was, he came to the only conclusion he could, that he was Jesus.
Mm.
So he didn't necessarily want to be.
Yes.
Mm.
That's what he says.
And he's in Australia?
He's in Australia now, yeah.
Yeah.
And he has done a bit of touring. But
yes, all right.
So most people have said to me, you know, it sounds quite good what they're saying about the soul. There's no way he's Jesus. Because it says in the Bible, Jesus is going to come back in a cloud and he's going to make everything else like this. But it's quite possible that if he gets to this oneness with God, he's going to transform like a butterfly. I don't know. And in a sense, that to me now isn't. It was really interesting to hear about all his answers about when he was Jesus, but
yes.
That's really not the big issue now.
Is he on the internet?
Yes. So it's if you YouTube is the best thing to look at, but Divine Truth is the channel on YouTube, and they've got a website, divinetruth.com, and that's got a good facts. FAQs,
mm-hmm.
and also because he knows his soulmate, he's found his soulmate.
Mm-hmm.
It's the same soulmate he had in the first life, and that was Mary Magdalene.
Mm-hmm.
And now it's even
right.
a bigger thing to swallow because
right.
now you've got wow, God.
Now we're getting there, aren't we?
Yeah.
Mm.
And I say, you know, it's worth looking at.
Mm.
And I've watched about 60 hours worth, but I find. It's quite easy to get put off as well,
mm.
like watching too much and intellectualising too much.
Mm.
Yeah.
Much more about the feeling and see how it affects you in your own life. And,
yeah.
But it was certainly thoroughly fascinating. I'm certainly loving it. Yeah.
Very good, thank you.
Have we gone past 9 o'clock?
Just.
Yeah. Oh.
So perfect time.
Yeah.
Very good.
And very, very interesting.
Good. I thought you'd find it interesting. And for example, you know, people we've been at the house and I've mentioned this to people, and you try and give it to them in a nutshell, and you can't get very far. It does require this sort of take you on this little journey without mentioning
yeah, yeah.
him before. Yeah.
Mm. Very good.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. I can play one more song to send us out.
It's you.
It's the other one I wrote.
It's you singing.
No one else who can be saved.